Magick. Ritual. 101. Introduction. This kind of blasphemy and swearing constitutes the worst kind of refuse and dregs of the earth, and punishment of these profane magi is well deserved. From Pseudo-Monarchia, Daimonome, by Johann Weyer. The scriptures of Western monotheism are very confusing. So open to debate are they that no two people familiar with them interpret their meaning the same way. The three major world religions formed around these scriptures have long attempted to unify their adherents' interpretation of the scriptures, and each has kept one-third of the scriptures as its sole possession, denying the validity of the other two without their own portion, which they unanimously claim to be the most necessary key to all the scriptures' interpretation. Because it is not human nature for anyone to interpret anything in exactly the same way as anyone else, these religions have long used the practice of magic to hypnotize their adherents into unanimous interpretations. But just as the three religions have split up their scriptures between them, so too have they divided among them the methods of magic they use to hypnotize their adherents. By doing this, they have divided among the three of them the single metaphysics of magic, and thus none of them fully understand the practice of magic, of which they each possess only one-third part. The result is the hypnosis of their followers by a third of the true metaphysics of magic. Only the recombination of all three monotheist world religions' methods of hypnosis of their adherents will restore the true and original metaphysics of magic. The true metaphysics of magic itself effects the exact opposite of hypnosis on its adherents. It awakens them to the true nature of the world. Thus, by dividing the scriptures into three world religions, each one uses a third part of the true and original metaphysics of magic to hypnotize their adherents. Only by studying all the scriptures of these three major world religions of monotheism can one begin to understand the true and original metaphysics of magic. This practice is the pursuit of awakening to a true understanding of the nature of the world. By recombining the scriptures of the three monotheist world religions, one accomplishes an awakening from the hypnosis of the three religions, which each demand the strict obedience of their adherents to one specific interpretation of their scriptures. To go into the details of the three monotheist major world religions' divided scriptures, or methods of hypnosis using only partial elements of the true and original metaphysics of magic, is irrelevant. No consensus of interpretation is possible, even in a couple. However, the facts that these religion scriptures are individually only partial, and that by dividing the true and original metaphysics of magic only affects hypnosis of their adherents, are undeniable. Despite the confusing nature of the scriptures of Western monotheism, the consensus opinion is that the basic premise of monotheism is, nevertheless, an absolute truth. Regardless of the endless debatability of interpretation of these scriptures, all alive will agree on the essential truth of the basis for belief in a monotheist God. The fact no two people can define their God exactly the same way is taken as proof of the existence of a single deity, common to all, approached uniquely by each individual. The universal law proving the omnipotence of the monotheist concept of God as a single deity is defined by its irony. Because the true and original metaphysics of magic has been divided, and the three major world religions of monotheism each only possess a part of its original practice. The common belief among all adherents of monotheism, regardless of their religion, is that the universal law proving God's existence is an ironic incompletion of any and all natural events without it. Because of the universality of this law of irony, we impute the existence of a single sentience superseding any and all natural events. This proof by the law of irony for the existence of a single omnipotent sentience superseding any and all natural events depends on the division of the scriptures among the religions that results in the hypnotism of their adherents. If the scriptures are recombined, the true and original metaphysics of magic can begin to be comprehended. At this point, the understanding, by the individual student of the recombined scriptures, of universal natural laws supersedes the belief in the proof for God by the universality of the law of irony. What is thus explained as the will of God by those who see only divided parts of the true metaphysics of magic is, by anyone who understands the scriptures in their totality, better explained as resulting from further natural forces than are yet comprehended by those who study only a divided form. The universal law of irony is replaced by the comprehension of the true metaphysics of magic in the mind of someone who has replaced belief in one single religion's interpretation of divided scriptures with the study of them all. This does not disprove the existence of God, nor does it replace the will of God with solely natural forces. However, it is only through a comprehension of the true metaphysics of magic, achieved by studying all the monotheist religion's scriptures, that we can better understand the existence and the will of the one true God. Dogmatic faith in the interpretation of a divided part of the monotheist scriptures provided by one of the three major monotheist world religions cannot provide as much or as complete a comprehension of the existence and will of God as is accomplished by studying the recombination of all three major world religions' monotheist scriptures. When we say that the law of irony, as proof for the existence of God willing into being any and all natural events, is not only based on a divided comprehension of the true metaphysics of universal law, but is altogether replaced by the comprehension of this true metaphysics, when one recombines all the monotheist scriptures and breaks the spell of the three major world religions of monotheism, we mean that all that which appears as ironic and is taken as proof for the will of God is comprehended according to its true cause, but this does not prove God does not exist. Nor does the complete comprehension of the true and original metaphysics of magic as only universal laws elevate an awakened adherent of a dogmatic belief in one of the three world religions to the status of God themselves. Just by knowing the way universal laws work, one cannot affect their will on them. Magic is defined as only manifestation of one's own will over any and or all natural events is incomplete. By knowing and applying one's comprehension of natural laws for someone whose knowledge is inferior to one's own may effectively accomplish the illusory appearance of such magic to an inherent of dogmatic belief. However, this is far from being complete comprehension of the true and original metaphysics of magic. The true and original metaphysics of magic, comprehended as all natural laws, supersedes the dogmatic faith in magic as simply sensory deception. Thus, all past definitions of magic as only manifestation by osmotic mental projection are false. Because a higher comprehension of universal natural laws allows only the illusion of magic as manifestation of one's own control over these laws. Because the three major world religions of monotheism each possess only a third part of the scriptures of monotheism and use their portion to hypnotize their adherents into dogmatic faith in a single interpretation of these thus divided scriptures. Because they lack a more complete comprehension of universal laws and so label irony as magic and proof of divine intervention. And because they use their third part of the complete comprehension of the true metaphysics of universal laws to hypnotize their adherents. For all these reasons, magic, as defined as manifestation, is ubiquitously outlawed by each of the three monotheist world religions. Each cites quotes from their own portion of the monotheist scriptures in support of this, but the ban on magic as the attempt to elevate oneself to the status of the one true God by manifesting their will over any or all natural events is unanimous among all three. This hypnotic dogmatism of belief in magic as merely manifestation has led to a ban on almost any new form of comprehension of natural laws. However, just as studying all the monotheist scriptures elevates one's comprehension of the existence and will of the one true God, so too does practicing magic in the form of studying natural laws break the spell of hypnosis cast by the three religions. This is the real reason magic is anathema, not because it is evil or goes against the will of the one true God. It is because it threatens breaking the hypnotic dogma of the three major monotheist religions of the modern world. Therefore, the true metaphysics of magic as universal law is neither known nor advocated as allowed to be known by any adherent of these three monotheist religions. Nevertheless, studying the recombination of the monotheist scriptures and better comprehending natural laws neither disproves the existence of God as an invisible omniversal sentience nor elevates the practitioner of such study to the status of such a deity. Magic is not an offense to God. It is a threat to religion's authority. Recombining all the monotheist scriptures allows one a better comprehension of the existence and will of the one true God, and thus of the natural laws that govern the causes of any and all natural events. This process can be defined as the true act of magic. Because the monotheist scriptures are confusing, there is no wrong interpretation of them. However, just as there can be no wrong interpretation of the scriptures, so too can there be no right interpretation of the scriptures. This applies in whole and part. The final moral of studying the recombination of all monotheist scriptures is that it is the will of the divided religions for one to do so, and that for better comprehension of natural laws, one does not only not need to study the scriptures in only one prescribed method of interpretation, but does not even need to study them at all. The awakening from dogmatic hypnosis to one of the three monotheist Western religions is accomplished through realizing that God's will manifest as natural laws occurs regardless of one's interpretation of the monotheist scriptures, or even one's own interpretation of the monotheist god. That is why religion forbids magic. Religious law is thus nothing but the attempt by humans to enforce prohibition over one's comprehension of universal natural laws. While it is possible for God to set laws for man, it is impossible for humans to make demands on God. The three religions interceding as intermediaries to affect the will of anyone over the will of God are practicing mass hypnosis using only partial truths. A specific quote, though not the only such example, on the prohibition against magic of any kind from the monotheist scriptures is Deuteronomy 18. There shall be none among you who sacrificially burns son or daughter, no one who practices divination, tells fortunes, interprets omens, or is a sorcerer, or a charmer, or a familiar, or wizard, or necromancer. From Deuteronomy 18, verses 10 through 11. While devastatingly specific in its condemnation of magic in all forms as were practiced at the time, the scripture remains confusing and incomplete. The literature of this era in the scriptures is meant to mimic the interpretation of the law of irony as proof for the existence and will of God. As such, there is a proliferation of alliteration, punnery, and rhymes that pepper the texts with colorful gems of pure onomatopoeic, perfectly harmonic cadence. The Hebrew letters form Semitic words that relate to one another like lyrics in a song, and which can be understood almost only, if not best, in its original language. Here we see Hebrew is pronounced keshef in Semitic, meaning sorcery. Likewise, kabar means to join, implying to cast a spell by making pacts. The word kesem is a divination for seeing the future. One who does any of these is called Yidianai, a wizard. However, what this monotheist scripture is outlawing is obviously something being practiced previously to its proscription against, e.g. what monotheist religions label magic. These arts lumped up such were the practice of the predecessor and foe of monotheist religions, e.g. pantheism. The study and practice of these arts of magic was outlawed by monotheism at a time when monotheism was first breaking forth from the pantheist religions of the era. At the figurative heart of monotheism's argument against magic as the practice of pantheism was the association of it with bloodletting or petro rites. Petro, Latin for stone, refers here to the herms, or mile markers along ancient roads that were fit with a crotch-height erect stone phallus. The herms of the Mediterranean and the mynheers of Europe were originally left over from an early Neolithic era of human development. Although their original purpose as distance markers along migrational routes of Paleolithic hunters was forgotten by the time of Deuteronomy, the practice of offering a bloodletting sacrifice at these locations was not. Thus, not only a few, but all of these monumental stone intersections were bloodied. The monotheist scriptures early on introduce the theme of juxtaposing life as blood and knowledge as vegetable forms of offering. They state that Cain, whom had offered unto the monotheist God a burnt offering of herbs, slew Abel his brother in a fit of jealousy for the monotheist God favoring Abel's offering of burning gore. Following from this, the sacrifice of blood is further associated with pantheism in the form of human sacrifice being less preferable to the monotheist God than animal sacrifice. Let us consider a concise recounting of the history of the bloodletting sacrifice in a series of paraphrased quotes from Wikipedia, the online open source encyclopedia. Quote, in Judaism, a sacrifice is known as a korban, from the Hebrew root korb, meaning to approach or draw near. Sacrifices were either blood sacrifices, animals, or bloodless sacrifices, grain and wine. Blood sacrifices were divided into the ola sacrifices, burnt offerings in which the whole animal was burnt, guilt offerings, in which part was burnt and part left for the priest, and peace offerings, in which, similarly, only part of the animal was burnt. There are three different subdivisions of slaughter offering. Thank offering, made in response to an unexpected positive change in circumstance. Votive offering, made in response to a positive change in circumstance when a vow in hope of such a change had previously been made. Free will offering, more spontaneous slaughter offerings. A holocaust is a religious animal sacrifice that is completely consumed by fire. The word derives from the ancient Greek holocaustos, which is used solely for one of the major forms of sacrifice. Holocausts are conducted at night without wine and offer black-hided animals at a low altar with their heads directed downwards. In all these, they are opposed to the commensal sacrifice given to the Olympian gods. Some of the ritual laws, or at least portions of these laws, involve two similar animals being brought to the priest, one being killed in a certain manner and its blood sprinkled onto the sinner, the other being sent away. Such rituals involve the idea that sin can be transferred from the sinner to the living animal via the blood of its dead associate. Shechita is the ritual slaughter of mammals and birds according to Jewish dietary laws. The act is performed by severing the trachea, esophagus, carotid arteries, and jugular veins using an extremely sharp blade, chalef, and allowing the blood to drain out. The knife used for shechita is called a chalef by Ashkenazim, or a seken. In previous centuries, the chalef was made of forged steel, which was not reflective and was difficult to make both smooth and sharp. In the mid-1700s, the Baal Shem Tov, fearing that Sabbateans were scratching the knives in a way that was not detectable by normal people, introduced the Hasidish chalef. The Hasidish chalef differs from the previously used knife in that it was made from molten steel and polished to a mirror gloss in which scratches could be seen as well as felt. The new knife was controversial and was one of four reasons listed in the Brodie Cherem for the excommunication of the Hasidim. Eid al-Adha, or Festival of Sacrifice, or Greater Eid, is an important religious holiday celebrated by Muslims worldwide to commemorate the willingness of Ibrahim, to sacrifice his son. The narration is referred to as the Akedah in Hebrew and as the Dabi in Arabic. Many Bible scholars have suggested this story's origin was a remembrance of an era when human sacrifice was abolished in favor of animal sacrifice. The Deus Ex Machina, salvation in some versions of Iphigenia, who was about to be sacrificed by her father Agamemnon, and her replacement with a deer by the goddess Artemis, may be a vestigial memory of the abandonment and discrediting of the practice of human sacrifice among the Greeks in favor of animal sacrifice. References to animal sacrifice appear in the New Testament, such as the parents of Jesus sacrificing two doves, Luke 2:24, and the Apostle Paul performing a Nazarite vow even after the death of Christ, Acts 21:23-26. In 330 to 340 AD, Alexandrian Bishop Epiphanius claimed to have defected from a sect called the Phibianites, which were claimed to worship a snake, have sexual intercourse during religious ceremonies, and eat aborted fetuses, considered to be the perfect mass. In later Scandinavian practice, human sacrifice appears to have become more institutionalized and was repeated as part of a larger sacrifice on a periodic basis, according to Adam of Bremen, every 9 years. Adam von Bremen recorded human sacrifices to Odin in 11th century Sweden, at the Temple of Uppsala, a tradition which is confirmed by Gesta Danorum and the Norse sagas. End quote. So we see that ritual human sacrifice continued in the West a very long time after the inception of monotheism's apostatizing it as an abhorrent practice of black magic. It was practiced by the Norse Vikings around the middle of the feudal Dark Ages, and mixed with Apocrypha brought back during the Crusades to ignite the Inquisition against the Albigensian heresy, e.g. the practice of pantheist magic in general. While there is much written in the histories about the blood libel against the Jews, or the false accusation of them continuing annual ritual human sacrifices today, there is no memorial of all the names of those tortured and burnt alive for failing to guess the question's expectation of a confession of guilt before the third degree. To say that ritual human sacrifice still occurs anywhere on earth now among the monotheist religions is considered criminal because, for so many centuries, the Ashkenazi Semitic exiles of Roman Judea were themselves sacrificed upon the flame. Just as the beginning of the shift in monotheism toward animal rather than human sacrifice began with the moral of the scripture on Abraham's preparation to sacrifice his son to the monotheist God, the blood libel curse on monotheist human sacrifice began contemporary to the beginning of monotheism shift away from bloodletting sacrifices of any kind and toward the replacement of it with bloodless offerings of food and drink instead. This was the era when the scriptures described the Christian Messiah, Jesus the Christ from Nazareth, being criminally tortured and crucified as a human sacrifice to the monotheist God by the Jerusalem Sanhedrin. The scriptures describe the Sanhedrin agreeing to an offer made by Roman procurator of Judea, Pontius Pilate, prior to the crucifixion of Jesus, that the blood of their human sacrifice should be not on the hands of pantheist Rome, but on the heads of the Jerusalem Sanhedrin, when they cried, "His blood be on us and on our children." This curse accounts in the scriptures for the historical expulsion of the Hebrew-Palestinian Semites from their religion's holy lands, Judea and Israel. The actual details of the blood libel ritual carried out to fulfill this curse upon the Jews placed on them by Pilate in the name of Caesar, then the god of monotheist Rome, began being circulated as early as 38 AD by Appian, and are here repeated from his writings by Flavius Josephus, the Hebrew rabbi legionnaire and nephew of Caesar. Quote, "Antiochus found in our temple a bed, and a man lying upon it, with a small table before him, full of dainties, from the fishes of the sea and the fowls of the dry land. He fell down upon his knees, and begged to be released, and that when the king bid him sit down and tell him who he was, and why he dwelt there, and what was the meaning of those various sorts of food that were set before him, the man made a lamentable complaint, and with sighs and tears in his eyes, gave him this account of the distress he was in, and said that he was a Greek, and that as he went over his province, in order to get his living, he was seized upon by foreigners, on a sudden, and brought to this temple, and shut up therein, and was seen by nobody, but was fattened by these curious provisions thus set before him, and that truly, at the first such unexpected advantages, seemed to him matter of great joy, that after a while he inquired of the servants that came to him, and was by them informed that it was in order to the fulfilling a law of the Jews, which they must not tell him, that he was thus fed, and that they did the same at a set time every year, that they used to catch a Greek foreigner, and fat him thus up every year, and then lead him to a certain wood, and kill him, and sacrifice with their accustomed solemnities, and taste of his entrails, and take an oath upon this sacrificing a Greek, that they would ever be at enmity with the Greeks, and that then they threw the remaining parts of the miserable wretch into a certain pit." Close quote. From Against Appian by Flavius Josephus. The accusation of ritual human sacrifice was repeated in the early feudal Dark Ages, the early 4th century AD, by Socrates, the Greek Christian church historian of the newly constructed city of Constantinople, sponsored by Emperor Constantine I, who converted to Christianity around the same time. Quote, "In this way they indulged in many absurdities, and at length, impelled by drunkenness, they were guilty of scoffing at Christians and even Christ himself, and in derision of the cross and those who put their trust in the crucified one, they seized a Christian boy, and having bound him to a cross, began to laugh and sneer at him. But in a little while, becoming so transported with fury, they scourged the child until he died under their hands. This conduct occasioned a sharp conflict between them and the Christians, and as soon as the emperors were informed of the circumstance, they issued orders to the governor of the province to find out and punish the delinquents." Close quote. From The Ecclesiastical History, Book 7, Chapter 16, by Socrates Scholasticus. By the time of Christian St. Augustine of Hippo, Algeria, around the turn of the 5th century AD, the blood libel was already deeply ingrained in association with the accusation of magic in general, repeated from the quote in Deuteronomy. Moreover, against those magic arts, concerning which some men, exceedingly wretched and exceedingly impious, delight to boast, may not public opinion itself be brought forward as a witness? For why are those arts so severely punished by the laws, if they are the works of deities who ought to be worshipped? Shall it be said that the Christians have ordained those laws by which magic arts are punished? With what other meaning, except that these sorceries are without doubt pernicious to the human race? End quote. From City of God, Book 8, Chapter 19, by St. Augustine. The French Pope, Innocent VI, born Etienne Aubert, issued a rejection of all allegations of the blood libel in 1247, reacting to the repetition of it by Thomas of Cambury, who said that solo sanguine cristiano, only Christian blood, had to be shed annually to cure the Jews of generational hemorrhages. Quote, certain of the clergy and princes, nobles, and great lords of your cities and dioceses have falsely devised certain godless plans against the Jews, unjustly depriving them by force of their property and appropriating it themselves. They falsely charge them with dividing up among themselves on the Passover the heart of a murdered boy. In their malice, they ascribe every murder, wherever it chanced to occur, to the Jews. And on the ground of this and other fabrications, they are filled with rage against them, rob them of their possessions without any formal accusation, without confession, and without legal trial and conviction, contrary to the privileges granted to them by the Apostolic See. Since it is our pleasure that they shall not be disturbed, we ordain that ye behave toward them in a friendly and kind manner. Whenever any unjust attacks upon them come under your notice, redress their injuries, and do not suffer them to be visited in the future by similar tribulations. Close quote. From Mandate to the Prelates of Germany and France to annul all measures adopted against the Jews on account of the ritual murder libel, and to prevent accusation of Arabs on similar charges. By Pope Innocent VI. In 1486 came the publication of the Witch's Hammer, a detailed account of alleged satanic sabbats involving the practice of all sorts of magic, including copulating with the goat-foot god Pan, provided from the confessions under torture of gypsies and pagans obtained during the crusade against the Albigensian heresy of Catharism called the Inquisition, begun almost 300 years prior. The Witch's Hammer makes it clear that the false accusations of Socrates Scholasticus remained unforgotten. Quote, the method by which they profess their sacrilege through an open pact of fidelity to devils varies according to the several practices to which different witches are addicted. And to understand this, it first must be noted that there are, as was shown in the first part of this treatise, three kinds of witches, namely, those who injure but cannot cure, those who cure but through some strange pact with the devil, cannot injure, and those who both injure and cure. And among those who injure, one class in particular stands out, which can perform every sort of witchcraft and spell, comprehending all that all the others individually can do. Wherefore, if we describe the method of profession in their case, it will suffice also for all the other kinds. And this class is made up of those who, against every instinct of human or animal nature, are in the habit of eating and devouring the children of their own species. Close quote. From Malleus Maleficarum, Part 2, Chapter 2. edited by James Springer and Henry Kramer. It was almost exactly around this time, give or take merely a decade at most, that we find the first publication of a grimoire, or book of magic, emanate from the Italian Renaissance. The Greater Key of King Solomon describes the attributes and images for constructing amulets that honor in Hebrew letters the seven planetary or Olympic deities. From this work we find the following description for how to make an animal sacrifice using the blood of a bat. Quote, "After this, take the needle or other convenient instrument of art, as will be said later on, and pierce the bat in the vein which is in the right wing, and collect the blood in a small vessel." Close quote. From Clavicula Solomonis, Book 2, Chapter 16, edited by S.L. McGregor Mathers. These grimoires have, for the last 500 years or so, provided the sole inspiration for the study of theoretical magic. They include theurgies and demonologies, evocations and invocations, hundreds of mathematical number squares, and countless squiggles symbolizing the signatures of hundreds or thousands of sentient spirits inhabiting limitless realms in an invisible landscape overlapping our own. Quote, "Take your kid, place it on a block with the throat turned upward, so that it may be easy for you to cut it. Be ready with your knife, and cut the throat at a single stroke, pronouncing the name of the spirit whom you wish to invoke. Whosoever would invoke the devil must sacrifice to him a dog, a cat, and a hen. These animals must be the property of the operator, who must also pledge himself to eternal fidelity and obedience, and must receive a special mark upon his body impressed by the devil himself. His recompense is an absolute control over three infernal spirits, respectively of earth, water, and air." Close quote. From The Book of Black Magic, Chapter 2, by A.E. Waite. And yet, what validity does such magic have? It is based on the history of the moral and legal suppression of blood sacrifices. It derives solely from the association of all forms of magic with human sacrifice. It is solely a study of self-proclaimed pagans now who are simply recalcitrant monotheists who know yet simply deny the idea of the existence and the will of the omniversal sentient one true God as it has been defined thus far by the three major monotheist religions. They call themselves agnostics, meaning that they neither believe nor disbelieve in the existence of such a God, but that they remain open to the possibility that one might exist. In short, they are open-minded Gnostics, who have studied all the scriptures of monotheism and found the true and original metaphysics of magic to be greater than them. They as often refute as affirm the validity of these scriptures, picking and choosing which bibliomancies to fancy debatable for the day. Yet, ultimately, they remain merely a modern byproduct of the three major Western monotheist religions. But we cannot cynically deny the validity of their belief in the simultaneous existence and non-existence of the monotheist God. Therefore, these grimoires of magic offer neither less nor more inspiration to a student of the true and original metaphysics of magic than do all the recombined monotheist scriptures. In truth, if there is a God, according to the specifications of a most high form of sentient mind, the nature of its thoughts would be ineffable to us regardless. What here follows is a collection of all the grimoires' most pertinent information arranged in the standard format of these books on practical magic. First, follow the terms of magic, in chronological order all the definitions thereof. Second, follows the history, describing the origins of the contents of the work. Third, follow the invocative prayers to be recited before undertaking the particular magical work. Fourth, follow the barbarous names of evocation in descending rank. Fifth, follow the lamens and sigils of these same. Following this, I will include additional appendices depicting all the relevant tools of these crafts and workings of this art. This work is not intended for any practical use, only for philosophical study. Engage in any of the dark evocations given here solely at your own risk.